This is Dr. Max Schultz, pastor of the Heritage Baptist Bible Church in Walnut Grove, Minnesota. It is our privilege to be with you now for this half hour, and we hope that you have your Bibles out and you're ready to follow along, because that's the only way that we learn the Word of God is to give it out and you take it in. We'll be back in just a moment. It is so good to be with you again this Sunday morning, as it is each Sunday morning at the same time. And again, it's our privilege to come into your homes and to spend this time with you. If you have your Bibles, we hope that you do. If you'll go ahead now and turn to James chapter 5, you always have a warm welcome here at church. If you're wondering what kind of church that we have here, well, we hope to present a church that has a lot of warm, loving people in it, and we believe that it does. And also, we're an independent church. We're a fundamental Bible-believing church. We do not belong to the World Council of Churches or Southern Baptist Convention or any of those conventions. We're an independent church. We thank God for that. The Bible is our textbook, and no one sends a little sermon net down from an organization to this preacher and tells him what's to preach each Sunday morning or tells him what his topic is. Those are taken from the Bible, and we thank God for that kind of independence that we have, and therefore the Word of God can go forth unhindered, unmolested. And we trust the power of God will lead people to Christ and those who have been led to Christ, that they'll grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. So basically, that's the kind of church we've got. We'd like to invite you to come. We'd be happy to have you come visit with us. We're now over here to the next to the last section here in verses 13 to 18, where we find out concerning the Christian that James says he is prayerful during trials. Now, we'd like to back up just a second, if we may, and we find out in verse 10 and 11, we'll recapitulate just a second. We find out here that during afflictions here, he refers the believer today to the Old Testament believers that suffered under the hands of sinners. Now notice in verse 11, "Behold, we count them happy which endure, and you've heard of the patience of Job, and have seen the end of the Lord, that the Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy." Now James uses the example of Job here, and we're going to use him again here in just a few verses. He uses him in this respect here of the trials that Job had been permitted by God to go through, that he was faithful, and even though he didn't understand. But we're going to find out something concerning his sickness also as we come to the next few verses. Now, notice here, if you will, in verse 12. It says, "But above all things, my brethren, swear not, neither by heaven, neither by the earth, and neither by any other oath, but let your yea be yea, and your nay be nay, and lest you fall into condemnation." In other words, James is not forbidding legal oaths, because when you go into a court of law, then you swear to tell the truth. Yes, that's true, and we have a right to do that, and the courts have a right to ask us to do that. But what he's referring to is, he's telling us, to have such an honest speech that we do not have to back it up with our promises and our oaths. In other words, well, I swear by this and one thing or another. No, they ought to know you as a Christian that when you say it, that's it, and you don't have to swear by anything. You see, the rich men did not keep their promises, but the Christian must always keep his word, even if it hurts him personally. Now we come on down to the next section here, prayerful during trials, in verses 13 to 18. This is a very interesting section. We're going to be on it for a couple of weeks here because of the misuse of this section by the phony faith healers today. And I say that with no reservations at all, because we're in such a time when, you know, we're not supposed to call things black and white. We're not supposed to say what they are. We're supposed to melancholy and just go on over it and so forth. And I might say this to you, because of preachers behind fundamental pulpits who have taken that kind of philosophy, that has opened the door and the floodgates for all kind of false teaching to come into the church, into the world, and that's why you have such a flourishing of it today. Because those who knew the truth did not exercise and stand up and on the authority of God's word say that is demonic, that is of Satan, that is not true, that is contrary to the word of God, because fundamental preachers, now I'm not speaking of all, because we do have some good fundamental preachers who do stand on the Word of God. We have some in this area, and that we're grateful for. But there are also some who have sold out, and they would rather have a large congregation than stand up and say, I'm sorry, folks, this is not what the Bible teaches. Those folks are wrong. And they wouldn't do that. Consequently, when you do not rebuke false doctrine takes a hold and flourishes under the guidance of Satan and his demons, and he loves it and loves to see it so. Let's begin now, if you will, in verse 13. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Then let him sing psalms. And is any sick among you, then let him call the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with the oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of the faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up, and if they have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. And then in verse 16, confess your faults one to another, and pray one for another, that you may be healed, and the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Now, I want to stop there and go back and examine these scriptures that we have read in light of the phoniness that is being projected today in disguise of Christianity, which is nothing more than a satanic philosophy and satanic doctrine. What are you saying? I'm speaking of the so-called, now I'm going to say this, and yet I want you to check it with the scripture here to make sure it's right. I've seen the Rex Humbards. I've seen the others that have in their so-called faith healing services. And if you'll notice carefully at the end of the service, is there any of you afflicted? Will you please slip out of your seat and come forward? You know, it's always amazing to me, and I might say this at the outset, that is as unscriptural, contrary to the scripture as you can get. If you will notice, first of all here, it says in verse 14, is any sick among you, let him call the elders of the church. And it is the sick who does the calling of the elders, not the pastor calling the sick to the front of the church. So when that's done, it is exactly opposite of what the Bible teaches as to who should do the calling, and not only that, the people involved in the calling. First of all, the pastor's not to call the sick. If they're that sick, I don't know what they're doing in church. And if they are well enough to come down to the front of a church, then I wonder if we have power to heal them, why the same pastor does not go out and go to the hospitals after church and clean the hospitals out of all the sick children and so forth, that he could do if he had that kind of power. But then we find out this, and I would mark this down, and I'm going to say this because they are phony. The ones that do this contrary to Scripture are phonier than a $3 bill and are nothing more than racketeers in the ministry. I remember when Catherine Coleman was one of the so-called faith healers, and yet she was right in the cesspool of faith healers around here, and there wasn't one of them that could heal her. See, the wages of sin is death. Catherine Coleman died. She could neither heal herself, and I might say this, that people do not realize or understand, but we're going to see this with Job, and I'm not going into it in depth, but I think there'll be enough to arouse your curiosity to search the scriptures further for the answer that a lot of sickness is caused by Satan himself and also by his demons. And I might also say that his demons, the ones that can cause some sicknesses now, can also cause the cure. And I might also add this. If Satan can make you sick and then cure you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving God the glory, you give God the glory for your healing, but you project a false doctrine of faith healing because you had enough faith to be healed when that wasn't the cause or the reason at all why you were healed, then Satan's glad to give you a healing that he caused your sickness to begin with, then he healed you, and you do all of this projecting a false doctrine. He'll be glad to give you a healing if he can get you to be the mouthpiece of satanic doctrine. He'll be glad to inflict you and then heal you. Just as long as you propagate the wrong doctrine, you'll influence a lot of people wrongly. You see, Satan is very wise, and he's no dumbbell at all, and we're no match for him. And the only thing we can stand on is what the Word of God says. But we like to go back now and take the case, for example, of Job. And if you have your Bibles, I want you to go back with me now, if you will, to Job. And let's go clear back here to chapter 1, if you will. We're going to find out something here, that it was Satan who inflicted the sores and the boils upon Job. It was Satan who inflicted the sickness here. But I'd like for you to find out something about this, because the characters and the, when I say characters, I do not mean actors. I mean real people here. The four friends of Job are exactly of the same philosophy as the phony faith healers are today. They neither understand God's purpose, they put all things in one category, they go contrary to the scriptures, and consequently they mislead thousands upon thousands of sincere seeking Christians who are not knowledgeable enough in the Word in order to refute their false doctrine. Now follow with me, if you will, and let's go to the book of Job, and I'd write these down, some of these verses here, and you begin to see here the philosophy of these men, so-called friends of Job. They exactly parallel your phony faith healers today. Now in chapter 1, we find out here in verse 1, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was, and I would underline this in my Bible, he was perfect, he was upright, and one that feared God and eschewed evil. So the character of Job was not in question, had nothing to do whatsoever with his being inflicted. Now let's go on over here, if you will, to verse 8, and let's find out again. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job? For there is none like him in the earth. He's a perfect and an upright man, and one that feareth God and escheweth evil. Now that's a pretty good reputation, isn't it? Now let's go on down now, if you will, or on over to chapter 2, verse 3. And we find out again what God says about Job's reputation. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job? For there is none like him in the earth. He's a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God, and escheweth evil, and still he holdeth fast his integrity, although thou movest against him to destroy him without cause. Now I'd like for you to go here to chapter 2, and notice here, if you will, in verse 7. And here is where Satan inflicted the sickness. And then you'll see what we're getting at in just a minute. And so Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his foot unto his crown. In other words, he was covered all over with maybe just open sores. He must have been an absolute, pitiful, pathetic, horrible-looking sight of a man. But we find out that Satan was the one who did it. God put a limit on it, how far Satan could go. He could not kill him, but he did allow Satan to inflict this physical sickness on him. Now, in light of this, here we have four men that were so-called friends of Job, and they got this thing all analyzed here as to what happened. Just like you hear these phony faith healers today misleading so many people with, well, now, do you have enough faith? Is it God's will? Yes, it is. Then I declare you to be healed. And we get a big crescendo on the organ and everything begins to work on our emotions and everything else. I declare you to be healed, and so on and so forth. And then we find out that if you are not healed, it is then because you do not have enough faith. I listen to the 700 Club, as I do periodically, to find out who has swung their way now as far as from the independent fundamental preachers. James Robinson was the last. I don't think that man knew anything about his Bible to go the route he went. But nevertheless, they had from Ontario David Maines up there. Most of you may be familiar with this man. He's a sweetheart of a man. He could almost give him a hug. He's so sweet. But anyway, you begin to find out that this man had a young boy on there, and the young man had been afflicted, had been run over or something, hit by a car, and was really in a pitiful shape. But the point I want to make is, I have no question about the young man's sincerity. I felt sympathy for him. It was in a pitiful shape. He had a real desire to serve the Lord, but too bad he got hooked up with Maines. And anyway, David asked him, he said, well, now, you have a, and prior to that, they had had a complete healing on the program, but now, he had a progressive healing, and he was just praising God for this progressive healing. I might say this, the man is a phony, phonier than a $3 bill, He is as false, satanic doctrine as he projects out. His name's David Maines on the 700 Club. And the man, there is no progressive healing that you find in the Bible from Christ. Whenever you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in the accounts of Christ, every healing was complete right now, and Christ did it, the apostles did it, when they healed, it was complete, and there was no progressive progression of it in any sense of the matter. What are you saying? I'm saying if Satan can afflict you and then heal you in any way, in order to get you to proclaim and align yourself with the faith healers, which always goes along with the tongues movement, then Satan is glad to see you healed if he can get you to be a promoter of false doctrine and false satanic doctrine. He would like to use you to persuade hundreds and thousands of people, and he'll be glad to heal you in order to get you to be aligned with false doctrine so you'll be an adversary of his. He loves that. Very sly what he does. But now notice something very carefully here, because Job was afflicted, and the conclusion of the four men was that, Job, the reason you are afflicted is because you have sin in your life. This is exactly what most of the faith healers claim today. Well, if you confess your sin, now do you really have faith? And they sort of slide off of the sin a little bit and put it over to the amount of faith that you have as a condition, whether you're healed or not. Now, I'd like for you in your Bible here, back here to Job, I'd like for you to go to the opinion of the first man by the name of Eliphaz. Turn with me to Job chapter 4, and notice here in verse 7 and 8. This is sort of interesting. Eliphaz was a man just like your faith healers today. He had the thing all analyzed. Now, look in verse 7 and 8. Now, speaking, Eliphaz is speaking here. Remember, I pray thee, whoever perished being innocent, or where were the righteous cut off? Now, he's talking about Job. Even as I have seen they that plow iniquity and sow wickedness reap the same. Now, he's applying this to Job. In other words, Job, you're getting what you deserve, old buddy. And then he goes on down. This is very interesting here. If you recall, when we studied the book of Job, you'll find out in verse 12 on down to verse 21 that Satan gives Eliphaz a satanic dream. Now, this is interesting. Notice here, if you will, in verse 12, it says, Now a thing, this is Eliphaz speaking and speaking to Job, he said, Now a thing was secretly brought to me, and my ear received a little thereof, and in thoughts from the visions of the night, in a dream, when deep sleep falleth on men, fear came upon me, and trembling, and which made all my bones to shake. What a horrible dream he must have had. And then a spirit passed before my face, and the hair of my flesh stood up. Now, he's really trying to impress Job, and there's no doubt he had this dream. In verse 16, it stood still, but I could not discern the form thereof. An image was before my eyes. There was silence, and I heard a voice saying, Shall mortal man be more just than his God? And shall a man be more pure than his Maker? And he goes on down, and what he does, this is nothing more than a satanic dream by Satan given to Eliphaz to assure him that his conclusions are right, that here we have Job who claims innocence. Well, can a man be more righteous than his Maker? And again, it is a false accusation against Job when his afflictions and his boils and his sores were not the result of any sin that he done. This was a testing from God. Your faith healers today, well, you can be healed, and the healing is in the atonement. We're going to be on this here in the next week or so. Your healing is in the atonement on the cross. No, it is not. That's a false doctrine. It is not. It is not God's will that sickness should prevail over any Christian's body. There's where you're wrong. There are times when it is God's will that the Christian be sick. There are times when it is not God's will the Christian be sick, but sickness is inflicted upon him because of disobedience to God. And there is other times, in the case that we're going to see of Paul, where he said, I besought the Lord three times, but a messenger of Satan came to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. And Satan wanted to afflict Paul, and God allowed him to, only to a point. And then said, that's it. That's enough. That will keep him humble. And then he learned a tremendous lesson, which he gave in 2 Corinthians 12. My grace is sufficient. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Wherefore I will glory in my infirmities, that the power of God may rest upon me. So there are times when it is God's will that the Christian be afflicted. And it's not because of sin. It is not because they have done anything wrong. It is all in the omniscience and the omnipotence and purposeful will of God that many times we do not know the answer to and never will this side of eternity. But the faith healers say, no, that isn't so. And here's where you come in with this in the book of James here. Now, let's look on over and look at something else. The next one was a man by the name of Bildad. Let's look in chapter 8 now, if you will. And he came up with the same thing as your phony faith healers today. Chapter 8, verse 6. He said, if thou were pure and upright, surely now he will awake for thee and make the habitation of thy righteousness prosperous. Well, that's nice, Bildad. That's really great. In verse 13, so are the paths of all that forget God, and the hypocrite's hope shall perish. Now, he's speaking about Job now. Say, you're a hypocrite, Job. And you know what? You're afflicted because of some sin you've done. No, that isn't true, and the faith healers make the same error today. Only you are the one to know and to surmise whether you are afflicted because of outright rebellion against God, or if you're leading the Christian life, then you may not know why that you're afflicted. And one thing else, you could be afflicted just simply because the body has ran out of gas and it is time for it. You must understand that God made these bodies, as he tells us in the book of Psalms, for 70 years. That is a score 20, three of them 60, add 10, that's 70. And if by reason we should live to 80, we ought to be very grateful and thankful for that. So we must realize that our bodies here run down after a while. In fact, the day that we're born, the body begins to die. And at the age of about 80, it has had it. And we are on our way out. So when we get sick at that point of time and so forth, it could not be that God inflicted it. It could just be that God allows the natural process of things to go ahead and take their course, as he only made this body for a short period of time on this earth. Now, let's go on here. That's what Bildad said. He parallels the faith healers today. Let's go to chapter 11 now, and we have another man by the name of Zophar. Chapter 11, let's look here, if you will, in verses 14 and 16. If iniquity be in thy hand, then put it far away, and let not wickedness dwell in thy tabernacles. For then shalt thou lift up thy face without spot, and yea, thou shalt be steadfast, and shalt not fear. And because thou shalt forget thy misery, and remember as it were waters that pass away. In other words, he implies that it is iniquity that is the cause of Job's problem, and there could not be anything further from the truth. When we come to this portion of Scripture now, over here to the book of James, there are some things that we need to realize concerning this. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. First of all, that man who is afflicted, or the person, or the woman, is to pray themselves. Is any merry? Let them sing. Is any sick among you? Let him call the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with the oil in the name of the Lord. Now, we're going to stop here and analyze this for just a second according to Scripture. Remember again, whenever you have a healing in a church and the pastor asks the sick to come forward, it is exactly opposite of what the Scriptures teach. The sick are to call the elders of the church, and they are to go to the place or to the person and anoint that person with oil. Now, we get to this point and begin to find out the anointing of the oil was a common used remedy at the day of Christ. Other words, and let's look at this, it was used as a massage. And notice here in Mark chapter 16, verse 1, if you will. Now let's go over there in your Bibles with me. Mark chapter 16, and let's look here in verse 1. Mark 16, 1, and let's see what it says. And when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and Salome, had brought sweet spices, that they might come and anoint him. Anoint him was massage the body or anoint the whole body, and it was a common used thing to prepare the body as it was for a living body or a dead body. To anoint it for burial, it was massaged all over, and the spices were put on, and it was anointed with oil. Those that were sick also were given a whole massage all over the whole body with the oil. It was used as a medicine. Now notice here, if you will, in Luke chapter 10, verse 34. Go with me over there, if you will, where we find out the oil and the wine was poured into a man's wound here. And it was a common thing that they had. They did not have the penicillin and the medicine that we have today. So let's look here in Luke chapter 10, verse 34, if you will. Luke 10, 34. Now notice here in verse 32, and likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him, and went to him and bound up his wounds, and pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his breast, and brought him to the inn, and took care of him. So he poured in oil, and he poured in wine for the disinfect, and this is what they had at that time to treat severe wounds and things like that. But it was a custom of the time. Now remember this, we have customs today, also as they had at the time of Christ. For example, we find out in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 5 and 6, where a woman's head was to be covered. If it was not, she was considered a prostitute. We do not have that custom today. We have a woman today, if she wears her dress clear up halfway between her belt and her knees, you can rest assured she's a big lead on. But a woman dresses appropriately, she's not considered a prostitute. You can tell them by the way they dress and the way they look. That was a custom with the woman's head to be covered. We find out also that in 1 Thessalonians 5:26, it was a custom to greet one another with a holy kiss. We do it today with a handshake. You see, you've got to understand what is meant by the custom of the time. When it tells us to anoint the person who calls to be sick, it was their custom to do that because that is the way they did it at that particular time. Now, I see our time's going. We're going to have to stop. We've run out of time. But let me say this to you in closing. We'll continue on this line of thought now concerning what these scriptures teach about healing and so forth. But let me say this to you. The biggest healing you'll ever have is spiritually, so that you're healed from paying for your own sin in hell and healed by the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. He loved you. He died for you, as he did me and everyone in the world. And personally, if you will put your faith in Christ, you will never perish but have eternal life, and you'll be spiritually healed. And I'll tell you, that's a far better healing than even physically being healed.
If you're listening today and you do not know that you have eternal life, you're not absolutely sure that you're going to heaven when you die, then here's how simple that it is. God has concluded we all have sinned, that you and I. God has also said that he loves the sinner. And we find out in Romans 5:8, God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And then in John 3:16, God loved the world. He loves you. He gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would never perish, but have everlasting life. If you realize you're a sinner and Christ is a wonderful Savior, and he died on that cross to save you from spending eternity in hell, so you could have a home in heaven with him, he bought your right to live with him for all time and eternity. All he asks you to do is believe the record God gave of his Son, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Well, I want to thank you for joining with us. Our time slipped away. I'd like for you to join us in our World Wide Web, www.heritagebbc.com. And also, if you've never written us, you'll do that. It is Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Until next week at the same time, may the Lord richly bless you as we ever pray, even so come, Lord Jesus.